show you guys from the book.
Good afternoon. I'm extra excited today to be here. Even though I speak for 20 years every day, nonstop. But today I'm very excited to be here because 20 years ago I lived one block away from here and I used to come learn here. I used to come here 20 years ago. I lived right in the brown buildings across the street, one block away, East Broadway. See this street. And I remember those days, how it used to be, and now I came, I saw a new door. The door was replaced. And I see all of you tzaddik, and I already recognize few guys here from Queens that was standing waiting for me outside. Baruch Hashem. Everyone knows that in this place, the perfect Talmid Chacham and the perfect Baal Midos of the generation, at least in America, was learning Torah, and the blessing of his Torah is still in this place for eternity. Twenty years ago, I was across the street praying there in Shabbos, Minche. And there was one Talmid of Rav Moshe Zatzal. And I asked him, Alex, tell me something from Rav Moshe, something that you saw that it's not in the books. So he told me one time we went to his house to write thank you cards to all the supporter of Aguda. Me and another Bachur, we were riding it, the Rebbitzin was there, and at 10 o'clock on the minute, Rav Moshe used to go to sleep. Everything by him was by the minute. This is, by the way, the main key to succeed as a Ben Torah, that every minute count. So he said that after he went to sleep, maybe half an hour later, he woke up from the middle of the sleep. And he ran outside, and he came to him and said, Alex, Alex, forgive me, please, forgive me. And Alex said, what happened? He said, please forgive me first. So he said, okay, I forgive you, but please tell me for what I have to forgive you. So he said, I went to sleep without saying thank you and good night to you, and you come doing my job. In the middle of the sleep, he woke up after falling asleep because he felt there's something in Akara Satov. So he had to go out, even though it was against his schedule because everything was... And he asked him, Alex, asked him, Rabbi, how can it be that you're such a perfect person? How can it be? You're born like that? So he told him, no one is born perfect. If he is perfect, he wouldn't come to this world. I work very hard on it. And that was the story that this Alex, I don't know where he is today, that was 20 years ago right here. You are here, Baruch Hashem, getting the best tools to become the Mamshichim, the ones who would continue the Masoret of Am Yisrael in a generation today that is much, much, much harder than 20 years ago. The destruction in the world in the last 20 years is something that couldn't even happen in a thousand years ago. What happened to the world from someone who ran around for 20 years and see the downgrades in spirituality in different parts of the world, what's happening with the media and the internet and the way the people are, what happened in the United States, what is happening in Eretz Israel, Europe, other parts of the world that I've seen, the teenagers, people in your age, the challenges that they have, and to be Bnei Torah, and to stick to the Torah, and to work 100% on our job in this world, as the Torah says, Lefum Tzahara Agra. It's not so simple. I want to tell you from 20 years of experience one thing. Today, as always, but today especially, it's impossible to succeed and to overcome the nisyonos that this generation have without being connected to the Torah fully, full devotion, not just to read it and understand it in the mind, to live it, which means every second of your mind you should always remember the words of Chazal, Le'olam yaseh adam torato keva en melachto arai. No matter what businesses you be involved in your life, you be a doctor, you be a businessman, whatever you be, if you're going to make this rule today or even yesterday, that the Torah will always come in front of everything, then you will definitely be successful. If a person accepts on himself, Hashem helps him. Melechet tzadikim na'aset bidei acherim. In Monsi, where I came from, we have a yeshiva for Baalei Tshuva. We had a guy there, his name is Eliyahu. Before he became a Baal Tshuva, he was Eli, the personal trainer. We're working in Manhattan here, in a fitness place, with all kinds of famous goyim from the world of lies. And he was built with muscles, he looks like a gorilla, you know. And he was making a lot of money and becoming more connected as big Yetzer Hara, unfortunately. But mamash in the deepest darkness in a spiritual way, he found the truth of HaKadosh Baruch Hu and the Torah. He left it and he came to Yeshiva. From the minute he arrived to Yeshiva, he became so serious in learning that within 2-3 years, he already did what an average learner does in 20 years. It was unbelievable. There was no lunch break, no breakfast break, no dinner break. Only Torah, 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 Torah. He bought a lousy small car that in a junkyard they give it to you for free. That's how bad this car is. Just do us a favor, take it. Bring a tow truck. They argue who's going to pay the $50 tow truck in those days. This is the kind of car he had. And he was driving the car approximately three years that he was in Yeshiva. Brooklyn, come back on for Shabbos, Monsi, this, that. The car is driving. The car is driving everywhere. I say to myself, what a miracle that this guy doesn't have to waste a minute in a garage. 3 years he's driving this car. This car, every mile he drives, it's a miracle. One day he made Aliyah to Eretz Israel, decided to make Aliyah. So he sold the car to another Avrech in the Yeshiva that wasn't so serious. Unfortunately, not everyone in Yeshiva is a real learner. So I was thinking to myself, I wonder how long it would be until this guy would visit the garage. Why? This Eliyahu was a real Eved Hashem. Kol amkabel al atzmo ol Torah ma'avirim imenu ol derech eretz. What does it mean, ol derech eretz? If you ask the average Israeli person, what does it mean, derech eretz? The secular people in Israel, when they find a proof in the Torah to their agenda, they become very big talmidei chachamim. So every time they see a Haredi that misbehave, right away they wave a flag. Hey, derech eretz kadma la-Torah. You should have first manners. First you should be a human being, then you'll be a learner, a scholar of Torah. Derech Eretz is more important. But really what it means, Derech Eretz, it also means manners in modern Hebrew. What it really means, that before Hashem gave the Torah, the world has rules. Every country had their constitution. Even in Sodom and Amorah, they have horrible constitution, but they had laws. Every country had laws. Everyone had to pay taxes. Every country had army. You didn't need the Torah to come to tell you that you have to pay tax to build roads, and that you have to have manners, and you should not kill, and you should not steal. People understood that. The Torah taught us things that we never knew. Zo chukat ha-Torah. Kol amkabel al atzmo ol Torah, someone who say Hashem, it's me and you and the Torah, that's it. The rest, I don't care. Money, no money, I have nice place, not nice place, nice car. It's all not relevant for me. Give me just what I need to survive. The rest, just Torah, Torah, Torah. So what happened? כל המקבל על עצמו עול תורה, which means accept all, it's not easy to learn Torah. Full focusing, being serious. מעבירים ממנו עול דרך ארץ. Hashem takes care of everything. Motor vehicle, driver's license, picture, passport picture, Israeli consulate, supermarket, babysitting. This guy did not have all this. He is the only one in the history of Spring Valley there in Rockland County that got a driver's license without going to the motor vehicle. For whatever reason, by a miracle, they agreed to make him a license with his wife bringing a picture. It's against the rules. I said to him, how many hours you had to waste for this? He said, I didn't even go there. By Ness, pray to Hashem and Hashem help. Why? He accepted all Torah 100%. The next day, after the other person bought the car, I come to the yeshiva, I see the hood is open with smoke. I say, what happened, Yitzchak? What happened? I can't believe I bought this car. He gave me a good deal. But he told me he drove the car 3 years, no problem. I said, I'm a witness that it's true. He never went to the garage. What can I tell him? You're not exactly the same kind of learner, so by you it's nature. No more, no Ashgacha Nisit of Hashem. The Rambam saying Ilchot Deot like this. Keshem Shachacham Nikar Bechochmato Vedeotav. The Chacham, you see right away by his wisdom, by the way he talk, by his knowledge, that is different than the rest of the nation, right the way you can see. Kach Tzarich Sheyen Nikar Bema'asav, Bema'achalo, Bema'ashkehu, and all the other personal, intimate stuff of his life. The way he talks, the way he dresses, the way he behaves in the house, the way with his wife, with his children, the way he conducts business. If it's not perfect in any aspect, something is not right in his learning. It cannot be that a person will learn all his life and stay rotten. Cannot be, something is not right here. Maybe he learned to be a rabbi, to make money, I don't know, to be famous, for kavod, that they'll sing to him when he comes in, Tzu Sha'arim Rashechem, oh, the Mashiach arrived. Maybe that's what he wants. But if he comes really to be a servant of Hashem, then you see that the Torah reflects in every move. One time I went to Yerushalayim, I have a cousin, is an incredible Talmid Chacham, an incredible servant of Hashem. I believe that if I put a candy camera on his life for 1 year, I won't find him does one little thing against halacha. With all my heart, I believe it. Every morning, pray early, minyan, every second of his life, Torah. One time I took two gvirim from New York to Yerushalayim. I told them, let's go visit my cousin. It was around 10 o'clock at night. So they told me, how do you know he's ready for us? I said to him, he's always with the books anyway. It's no nafkamina. We walk in, he's going to be learning anytime. They told me, you're so sure? I said, 100%. I said, what if not? He said, there's no if not. We go there, you see, he's with the books open. As soon as we arrive to Mattersdorf in Yerushalayim, the door was a little bit open, and he was standing with a stander by the door because the apartments there are so tiny, there's no room to sit and learn with all the kids in the house, even though it was 10 o'clock at night. So he's standing by the door learning. After all day learning in yeshiva and teaching in yeshiva, comes home, continue to learn. So one time, I went to visit him in the yeshiva. And we were sitting, my friend and I, and talking to him, and everyone from the yeshiva comes with the Gemara asking him questions. This, Ayin Tosfot, this, Rashi, this Gemara, this one, this, Kushiyah of Ramban, Kushiyah of this. 1, 2, 3, it's a long line, one after the other, like computer. Then one guy came and said, Rabbi, there's a new Talmid, he wants to get accepted to the yeshiva. And it was a very big learning room, very, very big, maybe 200-300 people there. And the entrance to the room was very far, maybe 80 feet away. So he said to him, tell him to walk in, walk with him a few steps, I want to see him. The guy walked in, not even 20, 30 seconds. He walked, they walk inside. He comes and said, tell him to come tomorrow morning, 9 o'clock. He got accepted. So I told him, how can it be, man? You don't interview the guy? He said, how did you accept him? He said, I looked the way he walked, the move, the way he... I said to him, what, you read his mind? What's going on here? He said, this is all chazalim. Every move a person does tell you everything about him. If he's proud, if he's angry, if he's arrogant, if he's full of ego, if he's down to earth, he has good midot, bad midot. It reflects in the way you move, the way you talk. People think they invented America. Sign language, body language, all these specialists. This is chazal, 100%. The way the person moves his legs, the way the legs are this, the way his back is. Of course, the next day he's going to speak to him and see if he made a mistake or not, but he didn't want to stop the meeting that we had. So by the way the person walked and the way he moved, he already knew if he's positive or negative. This is how much the Torah reflects on the person. I've seen myself in the last 20 years with the Balei Tshuva that came up to the yeshiva, how they came in, and one day when they made Aliyah, what, like, nothing, there's no connection in any way, not the way they speak, not the way they dress, not the way they behave, complete different people. If you see a person learn and he has a lot of knowledge, but his roots is still not good, something is not right here. Today, unfortunately, the generation is sick with one sickness. What is it? Almost everything that is happening is external. Everything is from the outside, flashy, show off. The inside is not as it used to be. Today, there are people who got huge publicity because they have a friend in a newspaper which likes them very much, and do public relations for them. Publish their name until the whole nation thinks that they're the biggest Gdolei Torah. And you have big Gdolei Torah, Amitiim, real one, that are sitting and learning 40, 50, 60 years serious with Amala Torah. Nobody knows who they are. They're not looking for this publicity. And then later, when you say, my rabbi say this, they say, no, but your rabbi, nobody knows him. It's not in a newspaper. But the truth is, that Hashem doesn't care about all this show off and all this. He only cares about one thing. A person has to be tocho kevaro. Not only show off from the outside. The inside should be 100%. Not only the clothes and the hat and all the other show and the beard and all the rest of the things. The inside of the person. How many of us learn thousands of hours about emuna when a person gave us a check and the check bounced, we're ready to kill him? After 20 years of learning Musar and Emunat, what's happened? What happened? What? How can it be such thing? How can it be that a person learns so many times about certain things in Gemara, in Halacha, in Musar, in Ashkafa, and in every day of his life he does the opposite? What is happening here? You should know one thing. Every one of you probably come from a different house, different city, different background. The families are not all the same level. Sometimes you look at the boy and you look at the other boy. One boy looks a lot more religious than the other. He looks more frum, he comes from a more frum family. The other one looks a little bit on the modern side. It's not as strict, it's not as machmir. But in the eyes of Hashem, the other boy is in a much higher level than the strict boy that looks in a very, very high level. Why? Because when we come to this world, we come already in a certain level. Not all of us came to the world in the same level. You take three little children, 2 years old each, triplets. Someone just gave birth to triplets, identical twins, three faces, same face, you don't know who is who. You take a bag of pretzel, you give each one of them. And you come to the first one, you say, give me one. He gives you one, but he gets very upset. Give me another one. By the second one, he begins to cry. By the third one, he screams. The whole neighborhood comes. What happened? He doesn't want to give. Very stingy. You come to the second one, even one he doesn't want to give you. You just give him the whole bag. Give me one. No. Begins to. As soon as you reach your arm, begin to scream. You come to the third one, he takes one or two, and he gives you the whole bag.
three little kids. They just came to the world. They never heard Shiur Musar. They don't know how difficult it is to make money in this world. They don't know about Parnasa. They don't know about anything. They don't know. Who told them to be stingy or to be generous? How do they know about this? They came like this. How HaKadosh Baruch Hu decided that one will be stingy and one will be generous? What is this? He has a roulette that he turns it around. Oh, number 20 came. You have to be proud. Number 30 came. You have to be angry. It doesn't work this way. The answer is the Ari HaKadosh say, the master of Kabbalah in the last 2,000 years, every person comes to the world the way he left the world, which means Gilgulim, reincarnation. Rabbi Chaim Vital, in the name of the Ari. You left the world angry, but you were Shomer Shabbos. You came back to the world, you don't have desire to be Mechalel Shabbos. Piece of cake to keep Shabbos for you. You enjoy it, you love it. No Yetzer Hara to be Mechalel Shabbat. Why? You were already Shomer Shabbos. Hashem doesn't give you the same test if you got 100 on a previous one. You passed that. But there are things you failed. You're still an angry person. You still have no emuna. Still not generous enough. You're still not Baal Chesed, Baal Tzedakah. That's your test. That's why it's difficult for you. Sometimes you see by the women, modesty. She keeps Shabbos easy. Baalat Chesed, she'll cook for the whole yeshiva 20 years in a row without complaints. You tell her, make yourself 100% according to the halacha. Every day it's a struggle. Why? This is her tikkun in life. The harder it is for you, that's your tikkun in life. Sometimes people come and say, I like to learn these subjects, but I don't like to learn these subjects. Let me learn what I like. The answer is, we didn't come to a picnic here. Lefum tzara agra. What does it mean, limud Torah l'shem shamayim? Not only that you learn because Hashem say to learn, you learn even things you do not like to learn. You learn when you're not in a mood to learn. One student came to my cousin. My cousin asked him, why are you not coming to learn today? Why are you still in bed after Shachris? He told him, today I don't feel so good. I'm not in a mood. So he told him, what does it mean I'm not in a mood? He said, I don't have the head for Gemara today. I read a little book, Sipurei Tzadikim a little bit. I relax in bed. So he told him, the Rav, who told you that you have to learn Torah only when you're in a mood to learn Torah? You go to work only when you're in a mood to go to work. When you need the money to feed your children, you go to work when you cannot look at the job. You hate it. You suffer there. You can't look at your boss. He's an evil person. But why you go there? You need to bring the $200 today, otherwise your kids won't have breakfast tomorrow. So you go to work. To learn Torah, it's a very serious place of work. Hashem put you here. You are the employees of the boss, like Rabbi Akiva say in the Mishnah. The Balabai Dochek. Hashem is, he lets you tell, he lets you borrow, he lets you do things, but everything has been written. It says like this. One of the chief Rashi Shivot say, when Ben Torah goes to the street, he has to imagine in his mind, especially here in Manhattan, that there are two guards holding his hands and walking with him. The one Tzadik Ador and the second Tzadik Ador. The two Gdolei Ador. Imagine you walk with them in the street of Manhattan and they're holding your hands. Would you dare to look at something you're not supposed to? Would you dare to say something you're not supposed to? Ein ro'a v'ozen shomad v'chol ma'asecha v'sefer nichtavim. One time, there was an owner of a supermarket. He decided to sell his supermarket. He sold it. Right away, from the 10 employees, 9 of them came to retire, to quit. Give me what you owe me, let me leave. So why? I did not even come one day to work. You're already leaving? What happened? Give me a week, a chance. Maybe I'll be a better boss than the previous one. He said, no, just give us the paycheck and let us leave. So he asked them, why do you leave? So one of them told him, listen, I like to take a break between 2 and 4, go in the back and sleep. First thing you came, you put cameras in the aisles. I don't like to walk in a place when I see a camera on my head. Give me my money, goodbye. He left. The other one said, listen, I have a problem. I like to pick on my nose, you know, all kinds of things like this. Now there's a camera here, I don't feel comfortable. Okay, goodbye. One of them said, listen, I like chocolate.
So when no one was looking, I used to open the bar, take half of it, pretend it's full, and put it back and steal, you know, and I used to eat chocolate like this for free for 10 years. Now you put a camera, I cannot do it. I don't want to work. Everyone came with an excuse. Then one guy stayed. So he told him, why you don't want to quit? I said, why do I care that there is a camera? I did nothing wrong before, I'll do nothing wrong after. So I told him, you be the manager. I need somebody like you. You I can trust. Why? You don't have what to hide. I have a friend who's a very big businessman here in Manhattan. He has a big business. And I told him once, I am willing to do Shvua Deoraisa, that you are 100% kosher and clean hand person, and you do not owe money to anyone, you did not steal from anyone, and you did not cheat anyone in your business. So he told me, yeah, you're my friend, but how do you know? You're not here with me every day in business. I told him, because you're the only person I met ever that when I call his office, the secretary never asked me, who is it? What is it in reference to? Is he expecting your call? No investigation. As soon as you call, can I stick to Mr. X? Hold on. They transfer the call. They don't know who he is. How do you know? Maybe it's his enemy who wants to kill him. If someone your money is in hide from him. No investigation. There's nothing to hide. Everyone who calls right away should direct the call to him. They have nothing to hide. Everyone wants you, reach you right away. No, he doesn't have to go through the investigation. Hold on, he comes back. Hold on, he's busy, he's in a meeting, he'll call you back. The next day you call again. 3 weeks until he comes to the phone. This is the way we have to be. Mi ya'aleh be'har Hashem, who is going to go in the mountain of Hashem? This is the mashal, the nimshal is, who is going to inherit olam haba? Neki chapayim uvar levav. Someone that his hands is clean. He didn't say someone is a big talmid chacham. Neki chapayim uvar levav. Of course, it's important to be talmid chacham. But if you talmid chacham in midotav raot, nevela srucha bashuk tova mimeno. Chazal gave an example that when you hear it, you can't believe that they use such an expression. Someone is a big rav, big talmid chacham, but his midot are bad. A dead rat on the street is better than him. They couldn't find a better, cleaner example. They had to compare him to a dead animal on the market. They wanted to sound extreme, to wake us up, that none of your Torah will help you if you're going to stay rotten and a liar and a crook and not modest and lazy and not generous and not Baal Chesed. Two Chachamim in the Gemara, they came from the family of Eliyah Cohen. And there was a curse on that family that they all will die young. One of them lived to 40 and the other one lived to 60. The Gemara asked, why one made it 20 years more? Why not? Both of them learned Torah all their life. One learned Torah and taught to others. He cared about others also. So the 20 years that Hashem gave him, this is what someone who learned Torah, al menat lelamed, like Pirkei Avot says, maspikim be'ado lilmod ulamed. You're going to have enough time. Hashem ma'arich et yamav. Et mispar yamecha amale, Hashem says in the Torah. I will fulfill your days. I'll make your day full. What does it mean full? A day is 24 hours. How can you make it more full than 24 hours? The answer is you're going to have blessing in your life, in your time. Which means if you give X amount of years to teach others, ma'ani bechinam, afata bechinam, you give for others to teach, Hashem will add those years to your life. Or will take away all derech eretz. You're not going to have to go to work. You're not going to have to waste time in traffic. You're not going to have to do a lot of wasting of time. Why? Because you give from your time to others. Hashem will give time for you, which means the extra hours of your day will be blessed to learn, to become a real Talmid Chacham. It says like this. Ksheroim ben Torah, when we see someone is a ben Torah, שמתלבש במלבושים נעים. He would dress very fancy. יותר מכדי הצורך. More than what it's necessary. Or is full of pride and ego.
What's the reaction of the public when they see such a thing? What do you think? When the people on the street, they see that, what is the first thing that comes to their mind? If they see someone is all his life is in yeshiva, it's full of arrogance and ego, the way he dress, the way he talk, the way he treat people, what's the first thing comes to their mind? Alulim limos chas v'shalom b'yeshivot hakdoshot. This is exactly what's happening today in Israel. The Gemara said there will be few signs before the Mashiach would come. One of the signs would be ir'e chet im asu. Someone that is ir'at shamayim, the public cannot stand him. The people who are not in Torah, they're not religious. Until a generation ago, okay, you want to be religious, fine. Nothing to do with me. I'm not interested to be like you. Live your life, fine. Today they cannot sleep at night. They have to destroy the yeshivot. They have to fight you. They have to destroy you. Why? What happened? What happened in this generation that all of a sudden so many people hate Torah? What's going on here? One reason, the Gemara already said, that's what's going to be. Chochmat sofrim tisrach. People who write books, instead of admiring them for their knowledge in Torah and how much they teach and help the generation, they put them in top target for criticism, to go and fight against them until they destroy them. And second reason is because of what I just told you. Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul, Zecher Tzadik VeKadosh Livracha, one time he said in Yeshivat Porat Yosef more than 20 years ago, he said, we think that all the problems of Am Yisrael come because of the Chilonim, because of the secular people. I'm telling you today, all the problems come because of us, the Haredim. Why? How can it be? There's 80% secular, 20% Shomrei Shabbos. So Shomrei Shabbos is the reason for the problems? That's what he said. They asked him in Yeshiva, how come, Rav? He said, from them Hashem is not expecting a lot. He know where they came from, he know where they grew up, he know the education they got. What do you expect from him? But from us, Hashem expect. He check us with magnified glass, every move, every inch. From us, Hashem expect. So when we do something wrong, when we misbehave, when we do chilul Hashem, that the people hold of us, bnei Torah, and we make such a shame to the Torah, let's talk a little bit about the way to behave in yeshiva. Some yeshivot, they have dorms. Some yeshivot don't have dorms. You go and you sleep by your parents. And some yeshivot, people stay there to sleep all week. Everybody think, I'm here to learn Torah. What I do in my dorm, it's my personal problem. So I want you to know, right now you're young, one day you maybe move to yeshivot, that you're going to sleep there for 2 or 3 weeks or for a few months until you come, or it could be in Eretz Israel. Hashem is not only checking you in a bet midrash, how serious you are. He's checking you inside your room, how clean it is, how you get up in the morning, how you start your day, how you get dressed, how you come on time to the davening. Why it's so important? The answer is, that's called zikui arabim or machti arabim. You ask yourself, I'm going to be machti arabim because I come to the yeshiva, to the bet midrash, to daven shachris 10 minutes late? What's the connection? It's my problem. I read fast. The chazan goes slow. I get to Baruchu always with him. So what's the problem? I can sleep 10 more minutes. The problem is that there are people who are weak character. And when they see his friend to the room sleeping extra, he also wants to sleep extra. Why? This is the way some people are. And it admits what we call rifyon. And because of that, other people go down, even though it doesn't affect you necessarily, but it affects the people around you. It affects people around you with other things you do, the way you present yourself. And that's why it's very important. Honesty in yeshiva.
It's very important. What does it mean, honesty in yeshiva? You're not in business. In business, you have to be honest. But in yeshiva, what does it have to do with honesty? The answer is here.
Many people learn with chevruta, and every day they have problems with their honesty. Why? Chazal are teaching us, Le'olam yeh adam yireh shamayim baseter kevagalui, umodeh al ha'emet udover emet bilvavo.
What does it mean? A person has to be not only always speaking the truth, that the way he wants to speak and the way he thinks will always be according to the truth. Not only speaking. His mind will be already programmed only to the truth. Nothing else comes in, which is a very high level. Because some of us, we can get to a level that we won't say a lie. Like Rav Yaakov Kaminetsky, Zecher Tzadik Livracha, was 95 years of life, not one lie. One time I asked my Rav, Rav Berkovitz in Yeshiva, he was his Talmid. He told me, one time I realized that Rav Yaakov Kaminetsky does not eat fish in the Yeshiva. So I asked him, Rabbi, is there any problem with the kashrut of the fish? He said, no, the kashrut is very good. You don't like fish? What's the problem? He said, I love fish very much. So I don't ever eat the fish here. I've been following you. I see you never touch the fish. So he said, when I was a young man in yeshiva in Europe, one time we went Friday night to eat Shabbos meal by a family. And a woman served fish. And the fish tasted so bad. As soon as I tasted from it, I almost vomit. So I spit it out. And right there, the woman came out of the kitchen and she said, Yankale, you don't like my fish? What am I going to say? Your fish tastes horrible. What am I going to say? Didn't want to embarrass her. So the first thing came out of my mind is I don't like fish in general. So he said, after that, I wanted to eat fish. When I was about to eat fish, I remember what I told her. And I knew if I'm going to eat now the fish, it will make me a liar retroactively. So I decided that I will never touch fish ever again. And this was almost 80 years after when he asked him that. And he never touched fish all his life. Why? That it won't be one lie that he made. One lie.
So to reach to this level, you all know it's very difficult. Very difficult. But to get to a level that the heart is also like that, there's no even Hava Amina to lie or to say something or to consider it. It's much harder. How a person can be not honest in yeshiva? When you learn, you know your friend is right. Sometimes the ego does not let to admit.
You waste 2 hours bringing this mefarish and this mefarish. No, you try to... Fine! Me or she any? Who's going to save me in my svara akuma that I made? Maybe I'll find someone to support my opinion. 3-2 hours will go to a waste until eventually somehow you get out of the arguments, not admitting, but you let go. In the meantime, 2-3 hours bitul Torah. Why? Your ego. Not honest enough. To be a crook is not only in business, selling bad product or not fresh food. It could be inside the learning Gemara. I want to tell you something. There was one rabbi, his name was Rav Ziuda Tzadka, Rosh Yeshivat Porat Yosef. One time he passed away, and they came to his chevruta that was learning with him for more than 30 years every day. They told him, we want you to make a eulogy. So he said, how can I make a eulogy? I don't know anything personal about him. So they told him, you saw him more than his wife saw him. You don't know anything personal about him? He said, absolutely not. The day we set to learn, we made a deal. You want to learn with me? Yes. Do you want to learn with me? Yes. In one condition. That we accept on us that we sit to learn, we will never speak one word out of the learning. That's the rule. And we kept that agreement that we made from the day we started until the day he passed away. I don't even know anything about him. Family, nothing. We never got to speak about it. We only spoke Torah 30 years. Did you ever hear such a thing? It's in our generation.
What do you think? You become Gdol Ador for nothing? If I'm not mistaken, I have a story about Rav Moshe that one time he made here in Lower East Side a Siyum on Mishnayos. They ask him, Rabbi, you finish Mishnayos hundreds of times. What's the occasion now you make a party? Some food, you know. So he said, no, this Mishnayos is extra precious for me. Why? I finish it when I was folding my tefillin after Shachris every day. Most people, when they fold the tefillin, they go here, they go there, they check the phone, they look around. Nothing. 2-3 minutes every day, added up, Siyum Shas, Mishnayos. Take it for granted. One Talmid was very, very sick in Yeshiva. So they decided to make a list how much each Talmid would contribute for his refuah shlema. One guy say, a perek in Masechet Kiddushin. One guy say, I'll finish the whole Masechet Tanis. One say, I'll finish Rosh Hashanah. One say, I read the whole Sefer Tehillim. Everyone in Yeshiva contributing to maybe save the life of their friend. So they came to one of the Rabbanim there in Yeshiva. So he said, I'm giving him 1 minute of my Torah learning. So the one who was making the list was shocked. Such a tzaddik, he gives me only a minute. So I looked at him, he said, Rabbi, this is a life and death issue here. This one gave this one masechet, this one a perek, this one, you're giving only 1 minute? So I looked at him with a serious face. He said, you know how much I do in a minute? A minute of him and a minute of him is not the same. Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul says something incredible that all of you should never forget. You can learn all your life chevruta with a friend, both of you 100% devoted to the learning. But when you come to Shamayim, you and your friend will not have the same reward. Sometimes the difference of the reward between Reuven and Shimon will be like black and white. There's nothing to compare. The person who got less would ask Hashem, how can it be? Where is your justice? Why he got 10 times or 100 times more than me? The answer is, first Hashem sends the neshama into the world. Hashem knows the level of the neshama. Hashem knows who the parents are. Hashem knows how they grew up. Hashem knows the nature of the person, the laziness, the devotion. Hashem knows. So right away, Hashem has to adjust the reward based on who you are. But that's everybody knows already. That's nothing new. What's new is about what I'm about to say. Two guys learning in yeshiva, and a businessman comes in and say, I need a worker for today. Would you come to work for me for one day? I have a construction, I'm building something. One of the workers did not come, I need a hand. So they ask, how much you paying? That's already bad that they asked, how much you paying? But they ask, so he said, I'll pay $10 an hour. Ah, thank you, not interested. Right away, they go back to the Tosfot. So, okay, 15. So one of them begin to calculate. How many hours? 10 hours. 150. Now I'll pass. So listen, I really need a worker. You're doing a big chesed. $20 an hour. One, close the Gemara right away. No problem. $200, very good. He got up and he left. 5 minutes later, this businessman came back and comes to his friend and says, I need another worker. Can you come also? Say, no. I'll give you 25, but don't tell your friend. He said, no, thank you. Okay, 30, I really need you, $30, come. 30, 300, okay. And he closed his Gemara and he left. Those two already determined the Sachar in Olam Abba for eternity. Hashem will tell the first one, my Torah worth for you $20 an hour, that's what you're gonna get based on this calculation. My Torah worth for you only $30 an hour, that's what you're gonna get. What if one of them would say, no, even 100 not? So I'll give you $1,000 an hour. You're broke, you have no money. $1,000 an hour, you make $5,000, $10,000 a day. It would be enough for you to live a year learning. It's a yerida letzorech aliyah. This is all the calculation of the Satan, the Yetzer Hara is a genius. What do you think? It will offer you a treasure to close the Gemara. Two people sit and learn. One is facing the lake. One is facing the inside of the yeshiva. And a Jew is drowning. See, two hands like this.
He's about to die.
What's the halacha is? Pikuach nefesh. You have to put even the Torah on hold. You run, you save his life. So the one who was facing the lake obviously saw what's happening. The one who was with the back, he didn't know. So the one who ran first, he got the advantage. He's the one who saved the life of that Jew. So when he comes out, he feels great. Wow. First time in my life I saved the life of a person. Reality-wise, he got punished. Now you come and say it to a secular person, you know, he ran and saved life, this guy, today, but it was really a punishment from Hashem. You're not normal, it's crazy. What? Punishment? I wish I had the opportunity to save life. I'll feel great for 20 years. If you live according to the Torah, what does the Torah say? Gadol Talmud Torah yoter me'atzalat nefashot. Yes, you went, you saved life. But the fact that you're the one who saw it and had to do it, because there was the halacha, there was the requirement, don't feel so great about it. The 5-10 minutes that your friend learned Torah when you ran, it's already higher than this running. Rav Shlomo Zalman Oirbach, Zecher Tzadik Livracha, ask one of his Talmidim to do something that the hospital in Israel will keep an old man few more days inside in a freezing winter of Yerushalayim. The hospital threw him out. Said, there's nothing we can do to you. Go out. He's a homeless. So Rav Shlomo Zalman Oirbach was hoping maybe the snowstorm will pass another 2 days. Then the warm weather would come out, so he will manage this old man. So he said to his Talmid, see what you can do. Maybe you convince the hospital to keep him inside. So this Talmid went, and he started to tell the hospital all kinds of stories. So when they heard his story, he said, okay, bring him back in. So they took him in for a few more days. So he came back into the yeshiva with such a smile. So the Rav asked him, no? He said, Baruch Hashem, I told him this, I told him that. They took him back. So he screamed at him, but why are you smiling? So I'm happy that I got the old man back into a warm bed. He said, but you had to do it through a lie. How can you smile after you just lied? Yeah, it was a lie that was required by halacha. You don't want him to freeze to death, fine. But to be happy about it? That means something is not 100%. You have to check yourself out. So it says like this. Kodem shikanes la shiur. Student, before he comes into the shiur, ya'ayen basugiyah, will refresh his memory for what he learned yesterday or a week ago, whenever it was, or before Shabbos. Ki im lo ma'ayinim tov in a lunch break or in a recess, you don't review it. It's very difficult. It takes few minutes to go into the shiur. By the time you catch what's going on, you already may lose the entire hour. Will do everything he can never to miss a test. Test is not a punishment in yeshiva. Test is for your own good. Because that's the way to fight the Yetzer Hara and keep your devotion high. The time in the yeshivot is holy. Holy. Even a second to be late, it's a violation. I'm only late a minute, no big deal. When I was in yeshiva, there was one Talmid there that his head was totally black. He can't get anything. Mamash like a curse. It's like you're talking to him, you're teaching him, nothing. Nothing. 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, nothing. Everyone who comes to yeshiva after a month asks the Rosh Yeshiva, I want another chavruta. 3 years there. It's 1 month in yeshiva, is already better than him. I feel that he's holding me back. Rabbi, I'm sorry, he's a nice guy, but I want to progress. Imagine such a test, but he doesn't give up. But the Rosh Yeshiva every time say, when he gave a Musar talk, he said, I don't care about the clock. For me, the clock does not exist. For me, the Seder is starting when his Gemara is open. Why? I know he will never be a second late. He was never late. Always on time, sitting a few minutes before, ready for the Seder. But he was
so serious, even though he doesn't catch anything. But all of a sudden, Hashem opened up his head. Within months, he became a star in Yeshiva. Everything came up in a minute. It's like mamash, like a miracle. Sometimes Hashem is testing you. Another one, another month, another month, another month, and it opens up. Besdeh Chemed, one of Gdolei Israel in all the generation, he told a story about his life. He said when he was in yeshiva, your age, he was nothing special. Nothing. Below average. One time somebody made an alila about him, told a story about him. I don't want to go into the details. And because of that false story, he was forced to leave the yeshiva and go out of town. Rosh Yeshiva told him, I know you're innocent, but you staying here, it will cause so much Lashon Hara and Chilul Hashem. Better you give up, go away. When everything will be forgotten, I'll call you back. In the meantime, he went out of town. And this person who told the false story about him was using an Arab woman. But the Arab woman started to feel guilty about what she did. She cooperated with a lie. So she started to ask around, where is this Chizkiya Medini moved to? His name was Chizkiya, Rav Chizkiya Medini. They told her he moved to that town. So she went, the Arab woman, she knocked on his door and said, I'm very sorry for what I did to you. Please, come back to the yeshiva. She was the cleaning lady. And I will tell everyone that everything I said about you was a lie. And you're going to get in, your name will get clear, and I only ask you for one little favor. What? Say to the Rosh Yeshiva to let me keep my job. After I made tshuva, I confess. I go, yeah. So he got very happy, started to pack his stuff. Then after a few minutes, he told her, you know what, on a second thought, go back to the yeshiva, I'm not coming back. So she told him, why? Here, I'm clearing your name now. That's it. Tomorrow everyone would know that you're innocent. So he told her, no, no, it's okay. Don't worry. Keep your job. I won't tell anyone anything. Go back. Why didn't want to go back? Thinking. Until now, for 1 year, I'm out of the yeshiva. I'm alone here. Nobody knows me. I have to learn on my own. It's not ideal. If I go back to the yeshiva and the truth comes out, the person who told the story about me, everyone would look at him, and the massive Lashon Hara would begin, and big Chilul Hashem for weeks, and Hashem will be upset. I'll clear my name, but Hashem will be upset. I give up my name, I give up my convenience. I don't want to create Chilul Hashem. Let the person who did what he did to me, hopefully one day he'll do tshuva, I'm not coming back. And he wrote that after that, Hashem opened up his head. And from this moment on in his life, everything that he could not understand, in seconds he got it. His head opened up. Mamash, the gift from Shamayim. And he became one of Gdolei Israel b'chol adorot. I one time asked my cousin, how you became such a chacham? No one I met ever in the world is in your level. No one. And I met hundreds of talmidei chachamim. Such a head, you remember every beep, who everyone who ever say, all the opinions, Faradim, Ashkenazim, Rav Elyashiv, Rav Feinstein, Rav Ovadia, all the opinions about Giyu, everything in the head, every seif, how can it be such thing? And the hardest question, that the average posek sometimes need days for it. So he told me, what do you think, learning Torah, it's learning math or learning history? Learning Torah, it's 100% a gift from Hashem. And how Hashem decide who to give this gift? To the ones who prove that they are interested in this gift. The ones who are interested, Hashem gives them. Open up. The Zohar says that this world, the Zohar brings the purpose of life in a mashal, beautiful mashal. It's called Mashal Bat HaMelech. What does it mean, Mashal Bat HaMelech? The Melech, the king, has a daughter. She has everything. She's coming from in a royal family. She's righteous. She's, you know, everything's fine about her. Beautiful. So the king say, I don't know who to get married my daughter to. So I'm going to put her in the attic of the building. There are four floors in a building. And I lock the building with bars and the windows and everything. And the first guy that will make it all the way to the top where my daughter is, Kanauta, will become her husband. Hundreds of guys came. They all go around the building, try to find a way to break in. Everything is locked. Try to move the window, try to see maybe there's a hidden entrance. All day like this. Another one gave up, and another one gave up. The king is playing games. Another one gave up, another one gave up. After a few hours, one guy found a way. He turned it around. Oh, Baruch Hashem, I made it to the first floor. The same story now. Everything is locked. After a day, by the end of the day, almost everyone gave up. The person made it to the second floor, and he got stuck. That's it. He cannot make it. No matter what he tried, he's stuck in the second floor. The king showed up. Hi, nice to meet you. Welcome to the family. You're going to be the husband of my daughter. So the guy said to him, Your Majesty, but I never got to the attic. I'm only on the second floor. So the king told him, there's no way to get to the attic. I just wanted to see who is more devoted than all the others. Who is the one who will give up last? You're the one. Everyone gave up quick. Him. But you gave everything you could. I want you. In this world, Hashem doesn't expect us to succeed. He knows our limitation, but He expects us to do 100% effort. Imagine you have a car. You take it to the mechanic. The mechanic's supposed to fix it in 1 or 2 hours. He say, come back in 2 hours, your car will be ready. And he got stuck with that. He cannot fix the problem. 1 day, 2 days, 3 days. 1 week, the car is in the garage. You're losing work. You're losing appointments. Every 2-3 hours, you call, the car ready? Sorry, we cannot find the problem. After 1 week, the mechanic calls you, Erev Shabbos, come get your car. Oh, Baruch Hashem Shechianu, the car is ready? No. I couldn't fix it. What? Sorry. Every day I walk 10 hours on your car, 5 days, 50 hours, the car is not there. I can't find the problem. You come furious to the place, grab the key, and he say to you, $3,000, please. $3,000? No, man. $3,000 you have to give me for wasting my week. He said, I'm sorry, I work 50 hours, it's $60 an hour, $3,000. But you didn't fix the problem. What do you want from me? I still work. I worked for you, what, I'm your slave? He said, but you did not fix the car. Your mechanic is supposed to fix the car. But I worked, but you didn't fix. But I worked, but you didn't fix. They ended up in Beit Din. What's the halacha? Doesn't have to pay him anything. He didn't fix. Don't be a mechanic. But Baruch Hashem, Hashem is not like that. If Hashem was the judge in a case like this, He would give you the $3,000. Why? Hashem is giving us the reward based on the efforts. The efforts is more than the achievement. Lefum tzara agra. This is the most beautiful thing in Judaism. That we get the reward even when we fail completely. We achieve zero, but we put the efforts, Hashem give it to you like you did. Kol ha-rotze la'asot mitzvah ve'ne'enas. Someone who was on the way to do mitzvah, but for whatever reason he could not do it, ma'aleh alav ki'ilu asah. We'll finish with one last thing. There was a question in Pesach of two Jews in a ghetto that only had one half of a matzah. Which means 1 ounce, one kazayis of matzah. And they kept it for the night of Leila Seder. And then they had a question. They had a question, what to do to break it to half and half, which means each one of them will eat half a kazayis and will not fulfill the minimum obligation. Or they throw a coin or something and one would win and he'll do the mitzvah and the other one, too bad. He will not do it. What's the right thing to do? What do you think the right thing to do? That each one would show Hashem, I tried, so I ate half a kazayit, better than nothing. But I also thought about my friends, I'm not selfish. Or make a lottery, whoever won it, he'll do the mitzvah completely, and the other one will not do.
That's the halacha. If we answer from the heart, the answer would be half enough. You do your best, that's it. But the halacha is not like that. The halacha is they make a lottery, whoever won will do the mitzvah, and the other one is anus. Anus rachmana patre, it counts like he did the mitzvah. One did it because he could do it fully, so it's not anus. If both of them will did half and half, it's not anus. None of them is anus, because there's a way to do it. But now, when one won it, he became obligated, and the other one is anus, so both of them got full reward. This is it. Anus rachmana patre. The Rebbe from Klosenburg, Franz Klosenburg, when he came from the Holocaust to America, to Union, New Jersey here, he had 400 boys on a boat, survivors. I don't have to tell you how they look, how skinny, they had nothing, not even a bag, one shirt, one pair of pants, that's it, nothing else, no relative, no nothing. They on the boat. The Rebbe had one more pair of tzitzis, one more. One on him and one in his hand. And he said, I want to give it to one of you. But I really don't know to which one. So we will make a lottery now. The one who will win it, at least one more Jew will do mitzvah tzitzis. One wise guy got up. He had a dirty shirt. He ripped it from one side. He ripped it from the other side. He said, now I'm obligated by halacha. Why? I have four corners. Now you have to give it to me. Lo ta'amod al dam recha. So the Rebbe told him, very clever, there's only one problem. But Torah, it says, et motza sfatecha tishmor. I already made an announcement, it's like a neder, that I'm going to make a lottery. Too bad. You did it before, I was obligated to give it to you. Now, I'm not obligated. But I'm sure, if you're such a tzaddik, and you so much L'Shem Shamayim that the only shirt you have in life, you're tearing it not to lose mitzvah tzitzit, your number will come up. Which number you think came from 400 numbers? His number came up. And this is a Rebbe that lost 11 of his children in the Holocaust. 11. And when he arrived here, one survivor came to cry to him that he had one son and he lost him. And it doesn't give him rest. And they sit and cry for 40 minutes. And after 40 minutes, that Jew tell him, Rebbe, you are much more miserable than me. I lost one, you lost 11. Why are we crying for me? We should cry for you. He got angry at him. Chas v'shalom, I'm not miserable. I'm the happiest guy on earth. So he said, I don't understand. If you're so happy, why are you crying for one kid that I lost? If it's no problem to lose 11, so why are we crying for one? He said, because I go into your mind and feel your pain in your level. That's why I cry with you, because I feel the pain that you feel. In your level, you feel pain. But I don't have this pain. I know all man David, Rachmana, Latava, everything Hashem does is for a reason and for good always. Bezrat Hashem, you have to understand, it's a zchut to learn in this place. The master of Torah in this country was here, in this street, in this area. Thousands of stories came from here. In the last 20 years, I gave hundreds of stories of Rav Moshe in my lectures that made Baruch Hashem influence on thousands of secular people, that some of them, Baruch Hashem, already Rabbanim today, sitting and learning. Nothing encouraged the person more than a real gadol, that not only is a big chacham, that is also tocho kevaro, 100% in a midot, humble, down to earth, baal chesed, neshama of a Jew. And you know the story, the most famous story, which I'm sure you heard probably 100 times, that one Jewish kid crossed the street here and a car hit him. And Lo Aleinu, he died, and they ran upstairs to Rav Moshe, was learning Torah, and they say, one Jewish boy just downstairs in an accident. And he say, cannot be. Go check if he's a Jew. Rabbi, the kippah is on the floor next to the body. He said, cannot be. It's not a Jew. Go check. Rabbi, it's a Jew. It cannot be. Go check. He went, he came back after 10 minutes. How did you know? What, you an angel? You a Navi? How did you know? You're right. It was a goy. But there was a keeper right next to him. Apparently what happened, the goy was running after a Jewish boy here. And the Jew made it. But his keeper fell while he was running. And the goy got hit by a car. Hashem sent the car to save who knows what he wanted to do to that joy. The goy got hit and got killed, and the Jew made it. So he came to Rav Moshe and he asked him, I don't understand, but how are you so confident about it? What? Cannot be that a Jew hit by a car? It's the first time in history? He said, no. Accidents happen all the time. But one thing cannot be, that in a place I gave my life for the Torah under my house, a Jewish boy will get killed. That cannot be. This won't be in here, in this street. Because he knew what he gave for Hashem, for the Torah. And each one of you has the same obligation here. No one is less. You can be just as big, with no excuses, with no discounts. Don't comfort yourself. If you want it, you can do it. Bezrat Hashem, thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to speak here. Hope we meet again. Kol tov. Okay.